described as a place that is idyllic, unaffected by time, remote from reality. The original story is thought to be about a German village called Germelhausen. And of course, there are many mythical places and utopias we could talk about, but for our purposes, Brigadoon will do nicely. The story goes that the village became enchanted centuries ago, remaining unchanged and invisible to the outside world. But for one day, every 100 years, it can be seen and even visited by outsiders. This enchanted day is spent in joy and celebration. To me, that sounds like a wonderful place to live and an even better place to grow up, to practice in safety all the different ways of becoming yourself. Does village life play out like this in reality? Not always. Of course not always. Humans are flawed, each of us, and even in small towns, folks are not all playing by the same playbook. And those who seem to live outside our cherished norms are not always looked upon kindly, not always dealt with gently. Even in Brigadoon, there was strife, sadness, disappointment, disagreement, and even a death. Even in a mythical village, what? Is there nowhere to turn, nowhere to show up with your dukes and your guard down? There was a time when I would have said, well, of course there isn't. Then I learned there is more than one way to be part of a mystical, magical village. Please indulge me while I go back 24 years. I was a new director of religious education and new at a job. And I was new to Unitarian Universalism. There was a UU church in Stanford where I come from. I was a teen and everyone called it the hippie church. They had rock concerts there several times a year, and all the teenagers went. But I never met any of the church people. By the time I showed up at First Parish in Canton as a grown woman, with my four-year-old and my newborn, I had only a passing knowledge of what UUs were all about. I was there because I saw it as some sort of theological neutral ground. I had no idea what I was getting into. I was on the fringes of the Canton church maybe 2 years when I got a phone call. On the other end of the line was a minister I'd never heard of, asking me to come interview for a part-time job at Unity Church in Northeastern. She had to repeat herself a few times, as I recall. I couldn't make sense of what she was saying or why she was calling me. But within weeks, I was a DRE. I repeat, I had no idea what I was getting into. I stumbled through that first year using common sense and my mothering experience, but in retrospect, I was ill-equipped. So with the suggestion of my minister, Holly Bell, and the friend who had recommended me for the job, Martha Liebe, I went to a religious education week on Star Island the summer after my first year, where I was to learn and to grow professionally. And according to Holly and Martha, I was going to have the time of my life. It's wonderful, they said. You'll love it, they said. It's chock full of young people who will happily babysit for a few bucks, they said. None of that turned out to be true. My 7-year-old was having a good time pretty much right from the beginning, but my 4-year-old was nervous and clung to me, literally, and weighed almost nothing. I watched people enjoy the island and its religious education delights, feeling progressively more grumpy and resentful. By Wednesday, I threw myself across the bed and cried my eyes out, a phenomenon I came to learn is a common hump day occurrence for these week-long immersive experiences. That knowledge came in handy years later when I started taking youth and teens on service trips. Planned for Wednesday. Anyway, after my cry, I surrendered, and Dana and I settled into our own Star Island rhythm. And I began to see how this pseudo-village life might have some plus points. But all in all, I was not coming back. That I was sure of. Until I went to a nighttime youth-led chapel service. Yes, at last, someone was willing to babysit my children so I could go to this nighttime worship service. The youth-led chapel service happened at the end of the week, and it happened in a tiny chapel with no electricity. So everyone's crowded together in wooden pews, and the ancient of building is lit by dozens of lanterns with candles in them, hanging from brackets in the walls. It's like this, only one-tenth the size. It was magical. It was. The teenagers were strewn all over the place, all around the front, up around the podium, sitting in the deep window sills. I didn't know any of them, and I had never seen anything like this. And these did every part of the worship service. They took themselves very seriously. They spoke from bits of paper they pulled from their pockets, and they told about what Star Island meant to them, what being part of this one-week community meant to them, what this 1 week out of the whole year meant to them. For some, it was clear that the other 51 weeks were full of struggle, but somehow the knowledge there was some place where they felt seen and heard and part of, 1 week a year, that gave them hope and strength. Whew, this was all new to me, and I have to confess that this much earnestness, this much naked emotion made me very uncomfortable. Finally, the last stood up to speak. His name was Turtle. I now know him as Peter Squires, but then he introduced himself as Turtle. And Turtle told his story without paper. He looked right out at this people in this packed lantern-lit chapel, 10 miles out from the middle of the ocean. And he said, "So, back in June, on the last day of school, all the kids are talking about what they're doing for the summer, and I'm listening to them. Some of them are saying, oh, my family stays on the boat all summer, or we're going to Fire Island, or I'm going to tennis camp, or I'm going to band camp. And me, I think about Star Island and all of you, and I tell them I'm going home. I'm going home." I still get chills when I tell that story, even though I've read it 3 times this week. This story changed everything. I wanted that for my children. So now I would come back to Star Island, darn it. And I wanted that for all the kids that I care about. I now had a new, bigger vision for what Sunday morning, for what Sunday school could be and what it could provide. If 1 week out of 52 can be home, then 2 hours of every week could be home. If 1 week out of 52 could be home, then 2 hours out of every week could be home. It wasn't about curriculum or social justice projects or arts and crafts. Those are things we do, but what we are is a spiritual home. That's been my religious education true north ever since then. Because I work for you, it's your religious education true north as well. We take our first principle very seriously in our Sunday village, our spiritual home. We have one law, that's it. For those of you who might be visiting, the first principle of Unitarian Universalism, the number one thing we actually all agree on and try to live by, is that we affirm the inherent worth and dignity of every person. Every person, even you, even me, even your little brother, even the person in your way at the intersection. If you think that's easy, try it. I keep saying that when we really get that first principle nailed, we'll start on the rest of them. But this is what that looks like in our little village. When classes meet, we begin with a check-in, always. Most of you probably know what a check-in is. You go around in a circle and share something big or small about where you're at, as we used to say in the groovy 70s. And as far as I'm concerned, it's the most important thing we do. When we're all together in a big group, we sit in a circle, a really good circle where everybody can be seen by everyone. And we belabor and narrate that as we organize ourselves into perfect geometry. Because if we only see each other once a week for these few minutes, then darn it, we're going to really see each other. And we don't want anyone to go unseen. We might miss something important. Quote the poet Nayura Waid, things that should be asked often in every type of relationship. How is your heart? Is your breath happy here? Do you feel free? In our village, because trust is built up a week at a time, an hour at a time, year after year, amazing things are revealed and important things happen. In check-ins, things are shared that would break your heart or fill it to bursting. We never know what's coming, so like ninjas, we're ready for anything. Recently, I was sitting in with one of our younger groups, and the lesson was on Queen Esther. The kids chimed in repeatedly with questions and comments about wildlife. It was clear that our group knew a lot about wildlife and nature. The teacher answered two or three of the wildlife sidetracks with humor and enthusiasm, then kept trying to go back to Queen Esther, reading the story. The next question left us speechless momentarily. Why do people sometimes eat other people? We gave up and shifted from a lesson about Queen Esther to a lesson about anthropology. Because really, knowing about Queen Esther was never really the main thing. Last week, I was taking attendance upstairs, and I came upon a wild, giggling, screeching group piled into a closet that they had tricked out as a UU time machine. Their teacher stood leaning against the doorframe, loudly reading to them about Thomas Potter and John Murray and the beginnings of universalism in New Jersey. I just kept walking. A few years ago, on a Friday night social outing, it was planned for the youth group to go to Waterfire in Providence, and only youth wanted to go. Only one youth signed up. So rather than canceling outright, we figured we'd give that youth a graceful exit, the opportunity to say, oh, I don't want to just go with old people. But they did not take that out. They didn't seem to want to take that out. So our youth advisors made that trip, proving to that youth that they were enough, all on their own, absolutely worth the trip. And because we build up caring community and trust slowly and incrementally in our made-from-scratch village week by week, when big things happen, we are trusted, and we can be of use. Like when a teenager was suddenly in an at-risk situation at home, and the person they called for help was their coming-of-age advisor, their coming-of-age mentor, and within hours that teen had a place to stay, had the support they needed to complete their school year, while more long-term arrangements could be made. This young adult touches bases with me still several times a year from far away. Brigadoon, in thy valley there is love. It may seem like a thin connection, Sunday school community, in a piece of musical theater about an idealized village, and maybe it is, but I stand by it. Brigadoon, it was difficulty, disappointments, disagreement, and even a death, just like real life. But there was also dancing, singing, and enchanting storytelling, and even a little sweet territory of silence. It's the same in our little Sunday morning village. Like the villagers of Brigadoon, we have not stopped singing, we have not stopped dancing, and we absolutely have not stopped being enchanted by stories. We do have a little trouble with that sweet territory of silence. But hey, 3 out of 4 is not so bad. And one more thing, you may recall that I said that Brigadoon can be seen and even visited by outsiders. Our Sunday morning village has plenty of room for people of all ages, a need even. Remember the reading that Eva did? How might your life have been different if there had been a place for you? A place of men, women, and children where you were received and affirmed. A place where other people, some perhaps older, have been affirmed before you, each in their time. Affirmed as they struggle to become more affirmed truly themselves. It's not too late for your life to be magical. And a key element of our singing, dancing, storytelling village are the other people, perhaps somewhat older. Without their presence and their gifts, without all of you,